Welcome, dear students. I think the session of the mathematics has just got over. You got the link for English. Anyway, I have purposely shared the link 5 minutes before so that other students, meanwhile they are joining and taking time, we can watch, the part that we are done with from the same text. Madam rides the bus. So, would you like to watch that video? Yes, Tisha, Anya, Avdumbar, don't you want to watch? Yes or no? Anya, Sablo, say something. Avdumbar. Okay, I'm playing you. Please watch it, right?
Hi friends, this has been
passengers. Valley soon gets Hello students. Today we are going to study the story Madam Rides the Bus, written by Vallikanan. Let us talk a little about the writer before delving into the story. The Tamil writer, journalist, critic and translator R.S. Krishnasamy used the pseudonym Vallikanan. In 1978, he received the Sahitya Academy Award for his critical work called The Birth and Growth of Modern Tamil Poetry. He died in 2006. We shall now begin with the story. Right at the beginning, we are introduced to the 8-year-old girl, Valliyammai or Valli. She is the central character of today's story. Valli is a loner.
Good afternoon, sir.
She was observing the street from a front door.
Good afternoon, sir.
Playing with the children of her age. Among all the things she observes, she's particularly interested in a bus. The bus travels between her village and the town. She is envious of her friends who get to ride the bus and visit the town. She desperately longs for a chance to do the same. Often, one of her friends would ride a bus and describe the sights of the town to the other girls. Valli and her friends would taunt her and call her proud. Neither Valli nor her friends understand what proud means and use it as a slang. From this little interaction, we learn how certain foreign words infiltrate the vocabulary of local or rural people with changed meanings. Just as many villages wish to get a taste of city life, they also aspire for an English education. Let us come back to the story. Valli gathers information about the town by listening to the passengers who travel by the bus. She learns that the bus takes 45 minutes to reach the city and the fare for one way is 30 paisa. It is difficult for her to afford both way rides, but she does not give up hope. She plans, calculates and recalculates. One spring afternoon, she finally manages to board the bus. The good-humored bus conductor jokes at her precautiousness. He addresses her as Madam and incites laughter from the passengers. Valli soon gets busy admiring the interiors of the bus and the scenery outside. She has to stand on her seat to peer outside. A concerned passenger asks her to sit down, afraid she would hurt herself. She retorts that she is not a child because she has paid the fare like the adults. Next, an elderly woman notices her traveling alone and expresses her concern. Valli judges the woman by her unattractive appearance and behaves badly with her. The author then describes how painstakingly Valli has managed to save money for her trip. She has resisted the temptations of buying peppermints, toys, balloons, or riding the merry-go-round at the village fair. to escape notice, she has planned a trip around the time when her mother naps in the afternoon. All this indicates the intensity of her desire to visit the town. Next, we see Valli's first experience of a moving bus. The thrill of her first ride is expressed in how she observes the motion of the bus. The bus rolled on now, cutting across bare landscape, now rushing through a tiny hamlet or past an old wayside shop. Sometimes the bus seemed on the point of gobbling up another vehicle that was coming towards them or a pedestrian crossing the road. Suddenly, the bus encounters a disturbed cow running wildly in the middle of the road. Being too young, the girl fails to understand the cow's pain and laughs uncontrollably at the funny sight. The bus finally moves into the town. It is Valli's first sight of the town. Valli is filled with wonder at the abundance of glittering merchandise and people. The conductor offers to buy Valli a cold drink, noticing her reluctance to explore the place. She refuses the drink as she has no money to pay for it. Thus, little Valli proves her integrity. On the way back home, she is just as interested in the sights outside as before. However, soon she has her first encounter with death, which greatly dampens her spirits. The cow, which had been galloping on the road, has met with an accident. It now lies dead on the road. The ghastly sight fills her with terror, and she loses her interest in the scenery outside. She probably also realizes that her thoughtless laughter at the animal's plight on the up journey had been insensitive. She, however, regains her spirits by the time she reaches back to her village in the afternoon. She bids a friendly goodbye to the conductor, who invites her for another ride whenever she wishes. Back home, she overhears her mother's conversation with an aunt. The words spoken by her mother are symbolic in the sense that Valli can connect it with her recent adventure. Her mother says, "It is not possible to know everything that happens around us. Moreover, knowledge alone does not guarantee understanding." Valli smiles at the knowledge that her mother will never discover her secret. With that, we come to the end of our video lesson. Hope you like the story of little Valli. See you.
Yes, dear students, understood? It was a great recap. And
yes, sir.
Thank you for all of us. I hope you have enjoyed and it helped you understand the text well, right? So here we are now in part 4, which is page number 125. Can you see on your screen? Can we start with that?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So,
yes, sir,
what
your
mother been looking for you? So, in this part, you please tell me, where are they? In the town, at the village, in the bus, on the way back to their village, or going back? Or just on the way,
On the way to the village. Back to the village.
No, they are still there at the bus stop. Right? And they are just about to move. Let's see if they are moving. Is the bus moving or not? Let's see, right? Am I right? Here in the part 3, at the end,
yes, sir.
The conductor shrugged and they waited until it was time for the bus to begin the return journey. Again, there weren't many passengers, right? So, they are just going to start their journey back to their village. But they are at the bus stop. Let's see then what happens in the journey back to her village with the conductor by the bus, right? So, won't your mother be looking for you? The conductor asked when he gave the girl her ticket. And you know, now she is asking for the ticket, paid 30 paise. And there, the conductor again asked her a question. Then, won't your mother be looking for you? What she said? Let's see. No, no one will be looking for me, she said. The bus started. And again, there were the same wonderful sights. While going, she went from the left side of the way, roadway, and she is now coming from the right side, means to the left, while coming back from the town to the town, from town to this village. Right, dear students? Understanding? So she is sitting in the same place. So while going, she had viewed everything that was there in the left and in front, right? Now she is in the opposite direction and coming in opposite direction. So she is looking another side of the roadway. Am I right, dear students? She has not changed her place because she is now trying to get some another view. And here, even if it is mentioned that the sides were same, it means she was on the same pathway but could notice some of the things. What were they? Let's see. Right? Can we go ahead? Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
And then yes. The bus started. Here it is. The bus started, and again there were the same wonderful sights. So Valli wasn't bored in the slightest and greeted everything with the same excitement she had felt the first time. And you know, it didn't happen that she was bored. As I told you, that she was in another direction now, in the opposite direction. And she was still, you know, greeting those things, everything with the same excitement that she had felt the first time while coming to the town, right? But suddenly, you know, she saw something there that she felt sad. What was it? But suddenly she saw a young cow lying dead by the roadside, just where it had been struck by some fast moving vehicle. And you know, dear students, it happened finally that the cow that was running hinder and skelter, trying to escape herself from the roadways and the vehicles moving there, finally it happened that she met with an accident. And she was there lying on the ground just by the roadside. She was dead. And it was a fast moving, you know, vehicle which dashed into her, and finally she was there. In one of the videos you have seen that it was lying on the car, but no, it was lying on the ground by the roadside and died. Isn't that the same cow that ran in front of the bus on our trip to town? She asked the conductor. And you know, being so emotional and sensitive, especially those children being so innocent, right? She felt very sad for that. And the thing over it, you know, Siddhar, who became later. Do you know this story about Buddhism? Do you know about Ashoka?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Do you know about Gautam Buddha?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You know, they came across some sad thing, you know, he saw on his way. Somebody died and was carried by men and was felt, you know, that there is nothing in life, that human being is just striving and striving, and the ultimate, the destination is just death, that's it. And he thought over. But that much of, you know, spirituality and these things were not considered by this little girl, but she simply felt so sad for that young cow whom she had seen in her journey to the town, you know, running hinder and skelter with her tail high and trying to escape from the vehicles on the roads. And there she found dead by the roadside. And so out of curiosity, she just wanted to confirm, even if she was knowing from the conductor that it was the same cow that they had seen on their way to town, and the same cow they found on their way back to their village. So what did the conductor say? The conductor nodded, and she was overcome with sadness. What had been a lovable, beautiful creature just a little while ago and had now suddenly lost its charm and its life and looked so horrible, so frightening, as it lay there, legs straight, eagled, a fixed stare in its lifeless eyes, blood over. And you know, she is now describing here the dead cow, the animal that fell on the ground, lying over there, and a vehicle, the fast moving one, had dashed into it. She remembers the same cow, you know, running. She had clapped for her in a funny way that she found the cow was running. And there on her way, just after maybe not more than 30 minutes, not more than half an hour, she found the same cow dead, lying over there. No, it felt so much of sadness for this little girl being so innocent. She experienced something different in her life that is called as death. I think in the very first lecture I had also shared with you one incident from Kidgaon about two siblings, a boy and his sister. Do you remember?
Yes, sir.
Do you think he must not have felt very sad for her act, his act that he murdered? He did not want. He simply might have seen somewhere that, you know, there's somebody hits with the hammer. There is nothing. Because nowadays in the movies, you know, a person can jump very high up in the sky. Even if one jumps down from the 100-story building, he is there, standing still. There are many movies like Spider-Man and all, you know. Heroes are especially in South Indian movies are shown so strong, as if they are stronger than the iron. And they don't feel any, you know, pain in their body. But is it the fact, dear students?
No, sir.
No.
No, sir.
If only somebody just pinches, the pain we have, we know. And then that child could not realize because he had seen. If one hits with even hammer, there is nothing, no harm to anybody. And so he simply hit her with the hammer. And there he found that her, you know, completely bleeding and lying there in the blood state. And was finally dragged in the bathroom and had gone. You know, you must be feeling so guilty for yourself. What I did? How sane? And he must may go mad, you know, thinking all his life, I, you know, just being a child, did so and so. So sad it is. Likewise, this girl, the cow she had seen, you know, on the way to the town, she finds again on her way back to the village, dying, lying on the ground, so lifeless, eyes, blood all over, legs sprayed even. She felt so, so, so sad for that. And she is thinking over it. You know, Anandavar Virjan Patle, it is said in Marathi. It means, you know, how excited she was looking here and there and enjoying her life. And there, you know, it happened that she came across. Can you imagine, dear students, those people in 5-star hotels or in Bombay? 28th September, if I'm not wrong, or August in 2008, that Kasar, Ajmal Kasar, had simply entered with some of his companions and shot down all the people there, one after another, in the hospitals and all.
26th November.
Yes, 26th November. November. Yes, 26th November. Right. 26th November. So how cruel and wicked they are. Weren't they innocent? What had they done wrong with Ajmal and his companion? Nothing. But, you know, that they are spoiled mentally. They are fully filled with that much of agony, you know, how the world will end, you know, in the poem Ice and Fire. We have studied what Robert Frost has given there. There is agony, you know, the hatred that you have for somebody is going to, you know, encourage you to kill the people. But it should not be there in the heart. After all, human beings are not meant for that. We are there to live very happily, peacefully. And these great saints, they have contributed a lot. Many people, they have sacrificed their lives, like Hemant Karkare and all. You know, there were many people who sacrificed their lives just to protect the people. And finally, they were successful in catching Ajmal alive, right? Anyway, so here I just wanted to elaborate the sadness they felt for Kau. For a little girl, death of cow is like, for us, death of someone, you know, one of our friends or relatives whom you just met, and there you came at home and got the call that somebody is no more. Won't you feel very sad for that? Similarly, this girl also felt the same. Understood? Yes, dear students? Or want me to explain more?
Yes, sir.
With some more examples. I think it is more than enough.
Yes, okay. Sir.
So the bus moved on. The memory of the dead cow haunted her, dampening her enthusiasm. She no longer wanted to look out the window. And so simply, so excited girl was just standing in the window and looking here and there, and was sometimes clapping, laughing, smiling, saying anything that she wanted, maybe singing a song and all. She was found at her, you know, so desperate, sitting there in the chair, worried about that cow, missing her, how she was just running, you know. And it happened how the people. It was the first time that she had seen the death. If you remember one more incident, dear students, house is not home. Do you remember? I think it is there in class 9, supplementary moment.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
How he felt so sad for his, what was the animal? Cat?
Yes, it was a kitten.
Kitten, sir.
Yes, dear Anil?
It was a kitten.
It was a kitten.
But which animal? Kitten is for?
Cat.
Cat or dog?
Cat.
And for dog?
Cat. Dog's puppy.
Puppy.
For lion?
For lion.
For human?
Lion.
Baby.
Cub.
For cow?
Calf.
Calf.
Brilliant. So brilliant you are all. Very good. So let's then how she felt and finally what she did. She sat thus, glued to her seat until the bus reached her village at 3:40. And she was right as per her calculation. But it was 3:40. She had started off at 1. 1 to 1:42 and 2 to 2:40 she should have been there. But it was 3:40. It means she did not start at 1 but she started at 2. Right, dear students? Are you getting or not? Is there any reference
yes,
that she started at 1 o'clock? She had planned that she should start at 1 so that before her mother gets up, because she knows that mother goes to bed at 1 and gets up by 4 o'clock. Do you remember?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
so
sir.
If she had been there back to her village at 3:40, what do you think she had started her journey at? 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock? At noon. What do you say?
2 o'clock.
Yes, 2 to 2:40, 15 minutes here and there, and from 3 to 3:40, you know, there were no more passengers and it was a slack time. So the bus might have taken only 40 minutes than rather than 45 minutes, right? So she stood up and stretched herself and there she found that her stop was there. She was there in her village and simply had got very much tired and bored to see that cow dead by the roadside. You know, she was more worried and there she simply came and stretched her body and got up and is just moving out of the bus. What happens then? That's it. Then she turned to the conductor and said, "Well, sir, I hope to see you again." And then she is not angry, but being very humble, modestly, she is saying, "Well, sir, I hope to see you again. Bye." This is 1:80, no? I am not going to see you bye. I'll see you bye at 1:30. "Okay, madam," he answered her, smiling. "Whenever you feel like a bus ride, come and join us. And don't forget to bring your fare." And finally, you know, being very that kind of person, joking and funny, he reminded her to bring again rupees, you know, that fare, 30 paise, because after all, he's just an employee there and has to collect, even if there are his family members or relatives or friends, he has to collect money from them or not. What do you say, dear student?
He has to collect.
Is it in his domain to decide he should collect money or not? No. Whatever the government policies are there or the bus owner, he has to collect. If you remember, in class 9, there was a lesson, Bond of Love. How that sloth bear was attached
to yes,
the author's wife.
Yes,
and finally, when she insisted and was weeping and crying and begging before that curator, that please give me my papa back. We are all missing him very much. He is fretting, we are all fretting. But he said, no, it was not in his domain. He suggested finally that they should go to Bangalore and meet the superintendent. And finally he agreed because he was also a kind-hearted person. Similarly, you know, even if this person is asking Valli to come back and ride by bus, he is definitely reminding her to bring her money, that fare, right? So she laughed and jumped down from the bus. Then obviously went, running straight for home. And finally from that bus stop, she started running and finally reached her home. Then what happened? Let's see. When she entered her house, she found her mother awake and talking to one of Wally's aunts, the one from South Street. This aunt was a real chatterbox, never closing her mouth once it started talking. And yes, there are some people, they always, you know, love chatting. They may never keep quiet themselves. If you ask them to speak throughout the day, they will go on speaking. And that kind of an aunt was there, who was staying at the South Street and had come there and was having a conversation and was talking to Wally's mother, that aunt. And Wally's mother was talking to her. That way, you know, they were talking. What they were talking? Let's see. And where have you been? Said her aunt when Wally came in. And just Wally came in, entered her house, and there was that auntie who asked her, where have you been? She spoke very casually, not expecting a reply. She simply, hey Wally, where have you been? She did not want even the answer. She was not bothered much. She spoke very casually. So Wally just smiled. And her mother and aunt went on with their conversation. She said nothing, and not she wanted to share. Do you think she wanted to tell the aunt in the presence of her mother that she had been to the town all alone?
No.
Yes,
no.
Sir.
No, sir.
And then she heard her mother and aunt saying something to each other. What was it? Let's see. Yes, you are right, her mother said. So what is there? And what she said, you are right, we don't know. But let's see if we can get any reference. So many things in our midst and in the world outside. How can we possibly know about everything? And even when we do know about something, we often can't understand it completely, can we? And there is the communication, and mother is saying, yes, you are right, that in the world, so huge and vast the world is, you know, in a city there are lakhs of people, in the district, crores of people, in the town, in the nation, in the world, so many people, so many things happening everywhere. So one cannot know everything in the world, right? That's what they were talking about. And even if we know that something is there, but it may happen that we do not understand. For example, it happens that something is there nearby with you, but you just go on searching it everywhere, and then you finally come to know, yes, it was there only with you. In Marathi it is said, "Kakhe kalsan gavala varsa." And even when we do know about something, we often can't understand it completely, can we? We cannot gain knowledge about everything. We cannot experience everything. Right? We have some limits with us being human. So you just need to focus on the things that you are interested in, or that is in your domain, that you can change. Right? Rest, leave it to God. Do your best, rest to God. Leave the rest to God, or to unknown power that you believe in. But you have to leave no stone unturned. That is what I am saying. Do your best and leave the rest. Right? Because it is impossible for a person to know and understand everything in the world. So difficult. Even it is difficult to understand our own. If you remember the summit within. It's quite a difficult task. And how can we know everything in the world? Not possible. And that's why here her mother and the aunt are talking about. Oh yes, Brigadier Wally. And she also added, because she had experience, there is an exclamation mark. Oh yes, it's very impossible that one can know everything, because she has done something and she wants that nobody should know about it. You know, there are some movies where one can understand the feelings and the thoughts in others' mind. How it troubles, no? Especially in Marathi, one of the movies is there. Even that fellow can understand, you know, what the ladies are especially thinking about. Later, he gets that superpower that what the birds are chatting or talking about, he comes to understand their language. And finally, he is being troubled very much. What is that movie? You remember, dear students? It is in Marathi. Chashma. What Chashma? In Hindi, there is one movie, Chashma Paddur, right?
Yes, sir. In Hindi,
Chashma Paddur, and in Marathi, similar name, Chashma Bahadur or something. When he wears that spec, if he reads any character from the story, he becomes like that. Even he has been shown that reading Charlie Chaplin textbook, one of the books, and he becomes like Charlie Chaplin and behaves like that. Then so there are so many such characters like Karna in Mahabharata, if you know. Okay, anyway, you got it here, dear students, that why she said, oh yes, and with exclamation mark, Vallid remark. What does she mean to say? That she agreed, yes, nobody can know everything. And neither aunt nor her mother was knowing that she had been to the town, right? And so she exclaimed here, oh yes. What? Asked her mother. What's that you say? Oh, said Valli, I was just agreeing with what you said about things happening without our knowledge. And so she simply added that yes, I just agreed. As you said, you are right to the aunt. Similarly, I just agreed that yes, it happened. That we don't know the things happening around us. And many things are happening without our knowledge. And one of them was here, that Valli had been to the town, but nobody knows. Just a chit of a girl, she is, said her aunt. And she is also little, you know, that kind of a lady, very frank and open. Those who speak more are really open-hearted, psychologically, we can say. And those who are just saying nothing, you know, they have many things to say, but they don't. Right? We are going to see in the tale of Custard, in the next poem, those whom we find a coward, but they are the bravest. We'll see in the next one. You will really enjoy it. Just a chit of a girl, she is, said her aunt. And hey, look how she pokes her nose into our conversation, just as though she were a grown lady. And here also, she behaved as if she is an adult, right? So Valli smiled to herself. She did not want them to understand her smile. But then there wasn't much chance of that, was there? So, you got your student? What is she referring to? And what was her smile on her face representing? And the last sentence here says, but then there wasn't much chance, was there? No, there wasn't any chance. It might happen in future that she and her mother are traveling by the same bus, the same conductor, and there she calls her again, madam, you are again here in this bus, and then starts the story. This is part two. Anyway, some stories, you know, they end with a question mark, but there is no answer expected. Simply, the question itself is an answer, right? Like the bond of love also ended that a sloth bear. Can one say that the sloth bear does not have any affection, does not have their own attributes, and they don't love the human being? Question mark is there. So such kinds of questions that they don't expect any answer are called rhetorical questions. The question itself is an answer. And especially this question is question type, also known as tell tag. Are you getting this question, dear students? There wasn't much chance of that. So this is a statement given. But tell tag has been added, question tag, was there. Since when sentence is negative, tell tag should be positive. And if the statement is positive, tag should be negative.
Negative.
Like I say, you have understood, didn't you? Right? Don't you understand? These are some.
Yes, sir.
You also add no? Some, you know, tell tags and question tags in our regular conversation. In Marathi or Hindi, we say, no? What we say? Now we add, even in English, it happens. Like instead of now, we say, you know, like that. So they are all question tags. Do you understand? Don't you?
Yes, sir.
So this is don't you, yes, is a question tag. Right, dear students? This is going to be 130. This is a story translated from the Tamil by K.S. Sundaram and illustrated by R.K. Lakshman, who also translated it. Question and their answers have already been shared with you. Do you find any question difficult here? Thinking about the
question? No, sir.
No, sir.
Is there something that you found in the story difficult? You want me to explain more?
No, sir.
So that
no, sir, it was interesting.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, dear Bhumi and everyone. Fine?
Very good, sir.
Interesting. It is also going to teach us many things. This story has really been interesting, but it taught us many, many lessons that are useful in our life, right? Do you agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that's it for today, dear students. Thank you so much. Have a great day ahead. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye.